And so seeing at a very early age, now I don't need to move to see you, but at a very, very early age, in order to see, I must move. Otherwise, there is this projection from the eye into this electrical activity, but I cannot interpret this electrical activity in a functional way. I cannot understand when there is a change in this electrical activity, it means that the wall becomes closer to me, because I did not initiate my own movement with respect to the world. So seeing means to correlate at a very early age, to correlate movement and visual system, to integrate the two, to compensate between the two, so that there will be an agreement, there will be a good model in my brain that represents the world correctly. No movies, electrical signals, which has to be correlated correctly with what happens outside. This means learning. Learning means that I generate electrical activity within a group of very particular set of cells. A network of cells is now active, but this activity has to be learned. I have to learn that this activity is related to this object. Otherwise, there is this activity. You can inject as much as you want this activity to my brain, but my brain cannot correlate it with something that is functionally relevant to my behavior. Is that point clear? It's a very important point, because this is the fundamental issue of memory and the whole activation of the brain. No screens, no music in the brain. When you hear Mozart or Beethoven, there is no Mozart and Beethoven, there is no music in the brain, there is electrical activity in a network of neurons. This group of neurons or that group of neurons. And a particular music, ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, means for you, the face of my wife, if, while learning that this is my wife, I succeed to generate a local network that always fires ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta when I see my wife. But I have to do this correlation. Otherwise, I don't see my wife. And the cat did not see the world, because it did not learn to correlate the world with its electrical activity, because it did not move. So if you are born totally paralyzed, you will not see. Totally not see. That was my second surprise. The 10% and this fact that there is no screen, and that you have to interpret the world while moving physically in this world. This is true also for audition. I just gave an example of visual system. So I summarize what I said, because this is the fundamental issue. The main question in neuroscience today is to ask how this network of electrical activity of specific group of cells, maybe a million nerve cells, are now active with its particular specific generation of music. When I say music, this is electrical activity. This cell tends to do ta-ta-ta-ta. These are these spikes. Another cell, while I see a face, ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Together, there is a philharmonic of a particular group of cells that were designed after learning to always, when it's active, represent something on the outside. And this is true for motor movements, or when I move my hand now, there is a group of cells that learned after I was a child and did like this to move my hand and to take the water. I had to learn it, and after learning, I generated a specific group of cells that now became friends, and this friendship among this philharmonic music, electrical music, is now representing the world outside of me, but also inside of me. So when I feel love, or other emotions, or fear, there is a particular set of cells that are now active, and I had to learn to activate this group to feel love, to be afraid, to be creative. It's a particular set of cells that are sitting there waiting to be taught by the environment to become a group of cells, working together, always together, representing the letter A, representing a face, a movement, a feeling. That's all. That's all that there is in the brain. No little angels running there. Only the electrical activity and chemical substances moving between one place to the other to generate communication, synapses. Okay. So now, and I will end by that in terms of introduction. Now the question is, how do you embed memory? what is the mechanism that enables me or you or anybody that is capable of learning to generate a network of nerve cells that are always there to start to interact with each other in a coherent way, and always when I'm active, you're active, you're active, you're active, and together we understand, so to speak, together that it represents something specific. That's the question of neuroscience today. What is the mechanism of generating assembles of active cells that represent something on the outside? That's the fundamental question. Now, there are a few breakthroughs in recent years that are related to this question, but also related to questions of repairing the brain when it does not remember anymore. Because you need to have the mechanism of memory in order to understand what goes wrong with the memory when you are sick with Alzheimer's, for example, or dementia. Or why don't I remember the name of somebody suddenly? Why can I not activate this group of cells that code for the name Yossi? I know the face, I don't remember to say Yossi. What is wrong with my network? Why cannot retrieve the information? Is it gone, or can I not retrieve it? These are fundamental questions, as you understand. Very basic question. And if you ask him what is the tomorrow questions, really, I think the tomorrow questions is what will happen to the brain of elderly people. I think it's a fundamental issue. We are getting older, and the older we will get, the more issues like this, dementia, Alzheimer's, will pop up necessarily. Because the mechanism is fragile, and we must understand this mechanism, otherwise we will be in a disastrous world in that sense. I really believe in it. Not only me, it's clear. There will be other burdens of elderly society, but memory issues will come up more and more. And many of us already feel it today, at the age of 60. The memory issue. So this is the fundamental problems, and I just want to highlight one interesting new result from last year, actually from this year, or actually 2 and 10 questions. One issue is the following. As I said, one of the fundamental questions is how do I succeed to identify the group of cells that code specifically for a given item? Let's say fear conditioning. There is this classical experiment by Pavlov. I can generate fear for the dog, let's say, or I can salivate the dog by doing this classical conditioning between the cheese and the sound, and this everybody knows. But which is the group of cells, particular group of cells, that is now responsible for this particular new learned behavior, to be afraid of the sound of a ring, for example? There is a new technology, it's called optogenetics. This is the futuristic technology that allows us to genetically mark the cells that are active. So some of my cells are active when I see Moritz's face. So Moritz is my friend. I look at Moritz, I know his face. There is a specific group of cells that are now active. Otherwise, I would not know that this is Moritz in the second row. There is really Moritz there. He's there. I'm not inventing anything. So Moritz or Nili Sikorsky is there. How do I know? Because there is a specific group of cells. Now, how do I mark this specific group of cells? So there is this fantastic new technology, and I don't have time to go into it, but you will hear a lot about this. It's called optogenetics. So there is a way to, because when this cell is electrical active again and again when I see Moritz, this electrical group of cells that are now active generate a specific substance that I can stain while it's active. And suddenly I see this group of cells becoming red, physically red. In the brain of the rat, when I make this rat fearful, again and again fearful, I suddenly see, because there is this new marking by optogenetic techniques, which I didn't tell you much about, you suddenly see a group of cells become red, or blue, or yellow. I can design the color I like. So immediately I can look at the brain of this rat, and I see this is the group of cells that are now active, correlated with fear. And then I can do the ultimate experiment that is now being done in London, not only in London, also in Jerusalem. You can activate this group of cells and ask the futuristic question, can I cause the mouse to become afraid without bringing any ring or any electrical shock? I just now activate myself electrically. I go to this particular group of cells and activate them. Do I retrieve the memory of fear? The answer is yes. we can now detect which subgroups of cells are responsible for fear. And I can activate them and I cause the animal to be afraid. This means understanding which group of cells code for something particular. We are getting to the point where we can locate particular set of cells that are responsible for anything, face, hand movement, and anything else, that, or love for Mozart or Bach. We are starting to detect, using this optogenetics, the set of group of cells that are responsible for memory. This is a dream of neuroscientists, and it's coming. It's coming. And this will enable us to activate this group of cells when it's not normally activated, and then recall the memory. So this is a dramatic time. I didn't touch at all about how this group of cells learn to generate this collective behavior via these connections. Maybe I should say one word. So when we are a group of cells, when we are born, we are rather randomly connected. So everybody on average is connected to somebody else via a mechanism called synapse. But when I want to learn something, I enhance the connectivity. I generate the connectivity, stronger connectivity between a subpopulation, and this subpopulation will become responsible for this item. So the question is, what happens when, how does these synapses know to become stronger connected and make this group of friends of cells? We know that in Alzheimer's, this friendship of cells via this strong connection deteriorates, and slowly, slowly the connectivity, not the cells in the beginning, the connectivity, the connections deteriorate, and each cell starts to act to be active separately, but the memory is gone, because the memory is the philharmonic music and not the individual instrument. So we start to understand Alzheimer's, and that's how Marta was in here in Jerusalem, starts to develop medication to enhance the bond, the synapses, so they will not detach from each other. It's very important, of course, for medication.